birthday.
Happy birthday.
Did you know that today is kind of the birthday of the church? That's what Christians celebrate on Pentecost, which, according to the church calendar, is today. So happy birthday. Just a few decades after the resurrection of Jesus, the message of Christ had very rapidly spread throughout the world, and that speedy advance of the good news all began with Pentecost. Pentecost is actually a Jewish celebration. It is a harvest celebration known as the Festival of Weeks. We read about that in the Old Testament. And in the first century, Jews were still traveling to Jerusalem to commemorate the Festival of Weeks. They came from all over the known world to bring the first fruits of their harvest to the temple and to present them to God. So every year at Pentecost, the holy city was full of Jewish pilgrims. Well, Acts chapter 2 reports that one particular year, only a couple of months after the death and resurrection of Jesus, in fact, on the day of Pentecost, all the followers of Christ, about 120 people, were all in Jerusalem. They no doubt celebrated the Pentecost. And they came together in one place. And suddenly, into their gathering came a sound like a very fierce wind blowing all around them. Scripture doesn't say that there was actually a wind, but there was a sound of a wind. And all of those gathered there saw what resembled flames of fire, and the flames divided into individual tongues, and it came to rest on each one of those 120 followers. It was the infiltration of the Holy Spirit into the first Christian community. God gave those disciples a visual and an auditory experience to accompany what was happening in their hearts and in their mind. Through their worship and their prayer and as a community gathered in faith, they were filled with the divine presence, the risen Christ that they had seen ascend into heaven. Remember, we talked about that last week. The risen Christ they had seen ascend into heaven made a spiritual return among those followers. And as a result, they were supernaturally empowered. Exciting stuff, right? Yeah, it is. They were empowered by God to relate the message of Christ to people whom they had never met. And they related that message in languages that they did not know, languages that were spoken by that vast many people who had gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate Pentecost. Those people were visitors there. And eventually they returned to their own nation, to their own land, and they took with them the good news they had heard repeated by those empowered disciples. That news was still fresh on their lips when they returned home. So by the indwelling of God's Spirit, then, the first Christian community was able to spread the good news to people from all over the world in that one morning, in that one place. There is no indication that the disciples knew what was about to happen. There's no indication that they were expecting the gift of the Spirit when they received it, or in the way that they received it. But they had advance notice about what would happen. On the very night that Jesus was arrested, he told his apostles about this imminent outpouring. He told them that he would send a counselor to them, or an advocate who would guide his followers into all truth. In fact, Jesus called this counselor the Spirit of Truth, who would announce to them what was yet to come. And what was yet to come was the building up of the church. And the work of the church would benefit the kingdom of God. The Holy Spirit would ensure that work continued. And the Holy Spirit still ensures that work continues from generation to generation in the name of Christ. And we are witnesses of this work of the Spirit in our own generations. We are witnesses. And what's more, we are instruments through which the good news of Christ can be shared and by which it is made manifest. And that is exactly what I want to say to you about the Holy Spirit this morning as your preacher and as your minister. As this person who stands alongside you week after week, doing the missions that we are led in our heart to do, I want to say to you that we are gifted and uplifted and filled to running over with this Spirit of Truth that Jesus has promised. The Spirit of God is living among us and moving through us to will and to work according to God's good purpose. We are like people set on fire by God, people learning to speak a new language, the language of grace and the language of mercy. And so we are evidence that the church has been birthed and that the purpose of the church is to bring God's kingdom to light and to life on the face of the earth. As your preacher, that is what I want to say to you. As your minister, who very fervently prays that God will grant me even just a morsel of leadership among you. As this person who hopes for, you know, just a tiny niblet with which to inspire you. That is what I want to say to you this morning about the Spirit that empowers. That is what I want to say. But as a person who grapples with being human, as someone who is often too hard on herself, as someone who gets weary from the grind, as someone who feels often overwhelmed with just the act of living, as an individual who feels too small for this great big world. As a single person who occasionally gets very lonely and who is often quite bored with her own company. As a mom who wishes that her children didn't have to live so very far away. As an adult child who still terribly misses her father and who worries about her mother's health and well-being. As a professional person who feels quite inadequate in her vocation. As a spiritual seeker who often has no idea what she is looking for. As your friend, as your companion who struggles with the frustrations of life, as just me standing here before you in all of my vulnerability, there is something else that I want to say to you about this spirit. It's good to grow churches and to build heavenly kingdoms on earth. Amen? It's a glorious thing to be invited by the living God to be part of something that is much larger and much more powerful than we are. Wouldn't you agree? It is a miraculous wonder for the coming of God's Spirit to move us and to propel us with power. But in the stillness of a very dark and lonely and sometimes worrisome night, have you been there, tossing on your pillow? During those havoc-filled, stressful hours of a day, you know what I'm talking about? During those times when we aren't so much involved in kingdom building, but just trying to get by minute by minute, day by day, we still need the coming of God's Spirit. We need it to embrace us and to steady us in love. In his letter to the Romans, the Apostle Paul so beautifully explains the intimate way that God joins with us in our weakness. Paul writes that all of creation is groaning to be set free from death and decay. And we also are inwardly groaning for relief and release. We're all subject to the suffering that comes with life. And so we are at times mournful about our current condition. But just as this holy presence was poured out on those first Christians, it is also poured out on us. It is poured out to strengthen us and to plead with us, Paul says. To plead with us and for us in our vulnerable state of being. The Spirit of truth that counseled the apostles, the advocate who was sent by our Lord to give rise to the Christian faith and to birth the Christian church. This helper that interceded on behalf of that first Christian community still intercedes on our behalf to pray for what we cannot give voice to and to express what we cannot articulate. I want to share a story with you. Very true story that was related to me by a beautiful Christian woman, a dear friend of mine, about the Spirit's intercession on her behalf. So my friend had hit bottom, as they say. Promises that were made to her were broken. Love was betrayed. Her marriage had fallen apart, and she was left to fend for herself in a city where she did not feel like she belonged, a city where she didn't want to be, a place where she really didn't know anyone. She was without friends, and her family was quite far away, and yet she was tied to this place because of a job that she couldn't leave. And so my friend told me that she felt completely alone in the world. And many of us have had that experience of complete and utter aloneness. Her heart was shattered and her spirit was just crushed. And at that point, she became kind of paralyzed by her grief. She wasn't really able to move forward on her own. She tried the best that she could. She tried to motivate, and she tried to summon up her courage. And she tried to pray. She tried to pray her way through. But she couldn't. She was completely empty. Have you ever been at that spot in your life when even prayer doesn't come? That's where she was. And then it was one evening as she sat holding her face in her hands, just weeping with her sorrow. From out of the depths of her soul, these words began to rise up, to bubble up, and just escape out of her mouth with very little effort on her part. Now these were not those unfamiliar tongues that we hear about and that we expect from the Holy Spirit. These were very familiar words, very intelligible words of great, great comfort. They were this. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. We are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Tears were just streaming down her face. Yes, Jesus loves me. An assurance that she was not alone welled up within her. Yes, Jesus loves me. The the Bible tells us so. Once a year on this day, we celebrate the birthday of the Christian church. But Pentecost takes root in each of us as the Holy Presence finds expression in our lives. When we know in our hearts that God is present with us and that the Spirit of God prays for us, in fact, groans for us, then we have come to know the witness of Christ born in our own spirit. And as this holy counselor guides us in all truth, to hear the language of love and to share the grace of God with all people, then we, yes, even we, in our own weakened state, even we are prospering the church and building the kingdom. And so we wait. We wait upon this outpouring Spirit to empower us and to uphold us and embrace us. We wait for the Spirit to speak through us and to speak to us. We hold fast to this hope that saves us, the divine dwelling in our very being, being birthed in us, birthing us to new life and to community in faith. We pray for this counselor to find us and to lead us and to make us a people of God. So then, come. Come, Holy Spirit. Come now and dwell among us. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.